5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Better than most.
How about him?
That is better than most. Better than most.
And works out of the shotgun. He takes it. Facing pressure. He's in trouble. He's spun around. He's able to get away. Looks to throw. He does downfield. And a leap catch is made. Down at the 25. What a play. Even Tyree comes up with the ball. What a play by Eli Manning.
Here is Brady Quinn looking. Pump fakes. He rolls to the near side. Throws it. It's caught by Samaja. Inside the 20. Inside the 10. He's going in. Notre Dame has scored with 27 seconds left. Brady Quinn does it again.
You're listening to another edition of Sports Today with Peter J. Here's your host, Peter J. Mulroy.
Welcome to the latest edition, Sports Today with Peter J. on this beautiful, at least on the East Coast, Friday, May 17th, 2024, a touch after 7 p.m. Eastern out here. So much going on. We continue to follow that theme the last couple of weeks, postseason basketball, postseason hockey, MLB, clearly off and running now. And we had the NFL schedule release. I'll get into that later in the program as far and including the PGA Championship underway, because it's more than just golf, especially concerning what is happening off the course. If you know, you know, and I'll get into it towards the end of the broadcast. Was going to start with MLB, but I want to start with the NHL tonight. Plenty of baseball as we go along, and NBA, and you know, all of it. Pack show today. Of course, you want to chime in and hit us up on the app. Those listening live across multiple platforms, you can log right in here on Podbean and call the show at any time. And of course, you can follow me on socials, Instagram at Sports Today with Peter J, J-A-Y. You watched that Ranger game last night, Rangers Hurricanes game six. Look, our buddy Joe, who calls in mostly every week, Joe Jet, diehard Jet fan, obviously. Big Ranger fan as well. You know, you're drinking the juice when the Rangers go up 3-0 in the series against a Carolina team that was a triple-digit point getter like the Rangers were during the regular season. And you're going, wow, if the Rangers are up 3-0 on a team like this, I mean, Carolina's a cup-worthy team. The sky's the limit here for this Ranger team. Tough sell to sweep a team like that. I always believed it, that I think the Rangers would crawl up and die. No. But it did get interesting, right? You're sort of watching game four. It never really became a discomfort to me where I thought the Rangers were in dire straits. Even after losing game four, not an enjoyable way to go down when you claw back. And then really the lousy effort in game five at MSG leaves a terrible taste in your mouth. Slow start game six. I think the Rangers had three shots on goal in the opening period, which is just inexcusable. But for whatever reason, considering you had the opportunity, if needed, to go back to the Garden for game seven, was thinking about it, not ever dwelling on it. But then you get the third period of yesterday's game six, where the Rangers went out of the first 40 minutes, just looked flat as hell. And this looked like it could have been a carryover from game five. Now the uh-ohs might be creeping in a bit more. And if you're a Ranger fan, you know exactly what I'm talking about. It's that uneasy feeling where the last couple of years, the Rangers have had 2-0, 2-0, and 3-0 leads and gone home. Especially last year going up on the Devils in emphatic fashion in games one and two. And then good night. It's over. And we've seen that the past couple of years with this team. So those thoughts creep in. You can probably have a similar conversation with a Toronto Maple Leafs fan about postseason deficiencies. So here we are going into the final 20 minutes of play. Rangers in a 3-1 hole. Now you've just got to make something happen. And you've had Ranger fans all postseason, and right for most of the postseason, and rightfully so. Mind you, going into the third period of this game, the Rangers were 6-2 in the playoffs. So win-loss-wise, they're playing pretty good you know, damn good hockey. But where's Chris Kreider? Where's the veteran? Where's the 50-plus goal scorer that we saw a couple seasons ago? Because you have Panarin. You have Trocheck playing well at both ends of the ice. Zibanejad doing his thing. Because when he gets hot, it comes in bunches. But there was that missing link of Chris Kreider. Snap of a finger, third period, here we go. Pops one off a rebound, it's 3-2. Okay, plenty of time left in this game. Kreider comes back, buries another one. We got a brand new ball game here, folks. And now the Rangers have that mojo back. And if you've been following this team all season, like I know many of our listeners have, you know exactly the mojo I'm referring to. There was seldom a moment this season where the Rangers looked bad, where they looked outplayed. Oddly enough, I saw them play early in the season against Nashville. Might have been their worst performance of the season at home, where they got outskated in every facet of the game. But one of the things about this Ranger team, and yes, they've got star power, and yes, you need that, is there's a motor that this team plays with regardless of what the score is, regardless of what the moment is. Look, Game 5 was a bad performance by the Rangers collectively, specifically late, which came right after the stall goal. You watch it, you know exactly what I'm talking about. I don't equate that as to quitting or giving up or sulking, if you will, to use a grade school term. That's a good hockey team they play. It's a championship caliber hockey team that beat them in their building and clawed their way back into the series. Rangers weren't sweeping. Carolina wasn't going to get swept. But the Rangers that we've come to know in year one of the Laviolette era showed up last night in period three. And it was spearheaded by one of the guys who drives the boat, Chris Kreider. Consecutive goals ties it at three. And then what does he do minutes later? He gets the natural hat trick, uninterrupted. Rangers go up 4-3. They bury one late. They outscore Carolina in the third period, 4-0. And the dagger, essentially the game winner, coming on Kreider's hat trick capping score late in the period. That's what you need, folks. That's the recipe for success there. Could see some concern on social media about some of the shots getting past Igor. Okay, fine. But what are you going to do in that situation? You're not parking your starting goalie like Carolina did when they sat Freddie. I heard those things on the national broadcast, the possibility for it. Saw it on social media. No, it's absurd. They needed the veterans to step up, and that's exactly what they got at the most crucial point of the season. You didn't want to come back for a game 7 at the Garden, regardless of being home or not. You didn't want to do it. And now the Rangers can prepare to play either Florida or Boston, where, let's face it, Florida's been one of the premier teams in the league all season. And if they're able to get past Boston in their series with Florida leading 3-2, more on the rest of the league in a moment, you're four games away now from going back to the Stanley Cup for the first time since they lost almost a decade ago against the LA Kings. But I don't even know if I would use the term up in class in the next round, because the team the Rangers just took down were a 101-point team during the regular season. That's a quality 6-game win for New York. And they spread the wealth there. You know, there were times where the power play looked unstoppable and the penalty kill was great. And there were times it was non-existent. That's something that will have to be significantly more consistent going into the East Final, regardless of who you play. But I thought this was a major step for this Ranger team, yes, but for the franchise as a whole, considering the writing in the past had been that this Ranger team blows series leads. First caller on the line tonight, Mike. Mike, what's going on, man?
Hi, Pete. How you doing?
Good. What's up?
I'm still stunned by this Ranger victory last night. But I was watching with a friend of mine, and at the after the first two periods, I wasn't too confident because I thought Igor had a tough first couple of periods, let a couple in that he maybe shouldn't have, and they hit two posts and a crossbar. But the thing I did tell my friend is that I don't think Freddie Anderson is that good. I said, they have no pressure on him. If they could pressure him, he'll let a few in. I didn't know if they would win, but I thought they'd make the game close. You know, a lot of guys like Freddie Anderson. I never thought he was that good. But
you know what's interesting about that concept there with Anderson, and you're right, and even the guys in Sean McDonough, I thought, with ESPN, continues to do a great job as the lead announcer there, working with Ray Ferraro. They basically said, you know, similar things, and I know those guys weren't on the broadcast last night, but yeah, you saw basically what you're saying there, Mike, is the Rangers came out flying in that third period, where if you can create that chaos, good things are going to happen. The message must have been sent in that locker room, because even before that first of three Kreider goals went in, you can see the level of intensity there was different, where it was almost reminiscent of how Carolina played at the end of the second period in game five, where they had opportunities and you said, man, if this carries over, Carolina's going to pop some home, because they were creating chaos. And what did that lead to? Three straight Carolina goals and a game five victory. The recipe there was very, very similar to what the Rangers did to Carolina on their home ice in that third period yesterday. And that's really started from the opening faceoff.
Yep.
Go ahead.
Yeah. And the way this playoff has gone, like the Rangers are a funny team. There are certain times they have games where they're not disinterested, but the intensity isn't there. The one thing they have to understand as a team, I mean, they're talented enough to win a cup, but they're not talented enough to play half speed and win. They have to go all out to win.
And I think part of the reason why I think that, especially when you get to this point of the year, and now when you could potentially face, regardless of who it is, a Boston or Florida team, it's going to be a physical team, right? We know that. And Florida's got a lot of team speed, and Boston's got that veteran-laden group who, ironically enough, was bounced by Florida last year, and Florida went all the way to the Cup. But I think for this Ranger team, the nice thing that you have this year that you may not have had last year, you know, it's your third line center in Wenberg, or your top line winger on the other side of Kreider, like a Jack Roslovic, who I thought played really well in the Carolina series.
Yes, he did.
That Brzezinski, Goudreau, Vizi line's playing very well, and the defensive intensity's there. You're right about what you said last night with some getting past Igor, you know, but I think between these combos, Miller and Trouba had a good game last night too, and I know he can frustrate the fan base, but that combo is continuing to work here. You know, these pairings, they're rolling out, but I thought really the Rangers' fourth line in the Carolina series was the real deal. And it's helped by, yes, the return of Hedl, but when you have guys like Will Cooley, Zibanejad pairing behind the Trocheks, Panarins, and Kreiders of the world, that's a big deal. And the Rangers didn't have that last year. As good as they were, they're deeper, there's more depth, and there's reliability line by line by line by line, which is huge.
Yep.
So I'm with you. There's a recipe for a cup run, which now we know will continue at least one more round. But yeah, if you're going to go snooze fest like they did at the Garden Game 5 against a Boston team or a Florida team, you better get the golf clubs out a little earlier than expected.
Yeah. I personally think they're going to play Florida, because I think Florida can beat the Bruins. Maybe I'm wrong, but Florida is a lot like the Hurricanes. Same type of team, and it'll be every game will be a dogfight.
Well, I mean, the thing with the Florida team, and that game is underway on TNT for those listening live, Game 6, Florida and Boston. in Boston is you can look at this Florida team, but if it's not a Barkov or a Kachuk or a Cousins from the physicality standpoint, I mean, this team can hit you in similar fashion to the Rangers with multiple levels. And oh, by the way, Matthew Kachuk, who's just an absolute freak of nature. You know, they're a dangerous team, as are the team they're playing. Boston gets out of here with a win tonight. Game seven is going to be a hell of a thriller down in the state of Florida. That's for certain. But I'm with you. I do like, regardless, if the Panthers go down tonight, I like them to take care of business and bounce Boston for the second year in a row. But Mike, as always, appreciate the call.
Pete, certainly. I enjoyed it very much.
Thanks, brother. I appreciate it. Yeah. Mike, obviously one of our regular callers here, just like Joe last week, big Ranger fan. And like I just said, we have people listening live, not just on Podbean, across various platforms. Panthers, Bruins underway, game six in Beantown. This is one of those games that you have an eye on, because a Boston win means a game seven. And the winner of that is going to get the New York Rangers, who will have home ice advantage in this thing as the President's Cup winner. So game one Eastern Final is going to be at Madison Square Garden, either against the Florida Panthers or the Boston Bruins. Out west, you've got really good hockey going on. You know, starting with that Vancouver-Edmonton series, with game six is going to be tomorrow night, 8 p.m. Eastern. This is a matchup of teams that are going to be really, really good for a long time. I think the New York Rangers are tracking in that direction. Sure, they've got some, yeah, if you want to call Chris Kreider the elder statesman, but the Rangers are a young team as well. The Oilers and the Canucks are going to be the teams that are out west that continue to make waves. And this matchup between the two of them in the West second round could certainly be an indication of what the future holds. That is going to be one hell of a game six. I like I do with this Florida Boston series, you know, I very easily could see this thing going seven games as well. I mean, you've got guys, JT Miller, Connor McDavid, Brock Boeser, Zach Hyman playing really good hockey. McDavid, one of the really young stars of the league. And now you have him front and center with the potential to take his Oilers team, if they can get out of this 3-2 hole, to a West final where they play either Colorado or Dallas, which outside of the last couple of games between the Rangers and the Hurricanes, in my opinion, has been the best series. Now, I like Colorado coming into this. They've got that experience in the postseason the last couple of years. But look, it's Dallas now who's can clinch this second round series if they're able to get the game six victory tonight, 10 p.m. Eastern, puck drop on TNT. Do I think Colorado keeps things alive tonight? I do. To bring that back to Dallas for game seven, which will be an arena that is on the verge of explosion, with that Dallas fan base just thirsting to get back to a conference final. You know, these are two teams that know each other well. Colorado coming off a 5-3 victory in game five. You got two 50-plus teams, win teams in this contest that really, in similar fashion to what we saw with the Rangers and the Hurricanes, didn't have too many areas that were subpar all season. You know, I think many expected that Colorado would be where they are. Dallas may be ahead of schedule, but much like we talk about the Edmonton-Vancouver series, here's another young star for the Avalanche. Nathan MacKinnon continues to be an absolute stud. Wyatt Johnston has been great in this series with 7 goals, 3 assists over this entire postseason. Both of these teams certainly cup worthy. I think it makes for a great game six tonight that I think Colorado will win, which will kick this back to game seven in Dallas. But this is, I mean, you know, you got one team in a final and it's the New York Rangers. Now the Rangers will wait to see if it's Boston or Florida with game six already underway between the Bruins and Panthers. And then you got Colorado, Dallas, Vancouver and Edmonton with a Dallas win and a Vancouver and an Edmonton win can set up that East, that West final for those guys over the next 24 hours. It's going to be fun to keep tracking. And as the postseason continues, obviously much, especially with this being a New York centric show and the Rangers still alive four wins away, I should say, from moving on to the Stanley Cup final, we will keep it covered here on STWPJ as well.
With you every week.
Sports Today with Peter Jay.
All right, let's get into a little hoops now. Coming off of the NHL stuff, which has been remarkable to this point. Similar fashion, the NBA. And you've got a biggie tonight in Indiana. Game 6, Knicks Pacers. With this Knicks team continuing to play well, despite an injury-riddled roster. You have no OG Anunoby again tonight. And I said this last week on the program. If the Knicks are able to reach the East Final, which would be remarkable to have both the Knicks, if you're a New York sports fan, specifically Knicks and Rangers, to have both the Knicks and the Rangers in their respective conference finals at the same time. I mean, you got to get out to the Garden if you can, because that's just the energy there. It's indescribable. It's something you have to feel. So that would be truly something special and something that we have not had, obviously, as many of us know, since 1994. Which is amazing. I was 8 years old the last time that happened, with the Rangers winning the Cup final and the Knicks losing in the final to the Houston Rockets. It's actually the first time I can remember crying over a sporting event. Wow, 8 years old. That's unbelievable. But so you got the Knicks and Pacers game 6 tonight. And the confidence of this Knicks team to me is very impressive. And the resiliency, I think, even more so. The Knicks got absolutely throttled in game 4 in Indiana. I mean, couldn't crack 90 points. And what do? They come back to the Garden game 5, slow start. But who picks them up off the turf, once again, is Jalen Brunson. And I think the beauty of New York's 121-91 game 5 victory to take a 3-2 series lead, and they can wrap it up tonight. Brunson goes for 44 in the game, and he's been a walking 40-plus player basically this entire postseason. That's great. But think about this. You had a Knicks team that beat an Indiana Pacers team that's been scrappy, that just absolutely obliterated you in the heart of America a couple of days ago by 30-plus points. And the Knicks come back and beat them by 30. On a night where their best shooter, arguably, Dante DiVincenzo, goes 4-14 and 0-6 from three-point land, finishes the game with 8 points, and you still win by 30. What has been fantastic for the Knicks here is when they were in dire straits, and folks, they still are, by the way. Remember, you don't have Mitch, you don't have Julius, gone for the year. Bojan got knocked out of the postseason against Philly. He's gone. OG's gone probably for the rest of this series. You could see him again in the East Final if the Knicks get there. But the reemergence of Alec Burks, 18 points in Game 5, and an efficient 6 of 11 from the floor. And oh, by the way, 17 rebounds for Isaiah Hartenstein, 12 of them coming on the offensive glass. He continues to be a lunch pail guy on steroids. That's how effective he's been. He brings whole new meaning to the term lunch pail. And everybody's favorite, Josh Hart. 7 of 16, 18 points, 11 rebounds. He continues to basically be the general of this team. McBride coming back in with 17 points, 3 of 7 from beyond the arc. And that kid's giving you minutes of quality. Picking up the scoring department, specifically in Game 5 when DiVincenzo had an off night, and he's been so spectacular that you can't ride him. Precious Achiuwa giving a solid 23 minutes. So the resiliency and the resolve of this Knicks team, you know what you're getting in Brunson. Matter of fact, this college coach from Villanova, Jay Wright, said last week, And he's right. And he was being completely polite about it. When asked about this ascension of Jalen Brunson, he says, "I knew he'd be good, but I had no idea he would be this good." Well, from a Knicks fan perspective, thank God he is. Because when's the last time the Knicks had a general like this? It's been a long time. I mean, you could put Mark Jackson in there. I know a lot of people were high on that Chris Childs era. I get it. But we have not had anything like this. And I say we, speaking about Knicks fan nation, anything remotely close to what Jalen Brunson has brought here. And now you've got a tall order tonight, 8:30 Eastern tip in Indianapolis for game 6. Pascal Siakam playing good basketball. Miles Turner playing good basketball. Andrew Nembhard really has done a great job in the 25 to 30 minutes a game he's been playing to give quality time on the floor. And then Tyrese Haliburton, not his best night in game 6, but he's shown up when Indiana's needed him. So we'll see what we get tonight. Again, for those listening live, with this game 6 with New York and Indiana. Because I'll tell you what, a game 7 at Madison Square Garden, which I know every single Knicks fan and every Knicks player wants to avoid. They want to get this over with and prepare for the next round. A game 7 at Madison Square Garden featuring the Knicks, you'd have to get there 24 hours early. You would have to get your rest. Because I can't put into words what that building would be like for a game 7 Knicks Pacers of all teams to go to the East final. Because we already have a game 7 out west, Wolves and Nuggets. Defending champs on the ropes. Fought back from an 0-2 hole, but here we are game 7 and they got pounded by Carl and company last night. If you watch that game, 2 beatdowns Denver's taken in this series. But Knicks, Pacers, if Indiana is able to pull this one out tonight to set up a game 7 at MSG with the winner going to the East Final to take on the Boston Celtics. I mean, this is everything you want, folks, as a sports fan. From the Knicks lens, I don't want to see a game 7. Because the last 10 days has led to migraines, lost sleep, minimal eating. Between the Knicks and the Rangers schedules, these late games, they kill you when you got to get up. I told you last week I tried the thing where I was setting alarms on my watch to wake up every 20 minutes. I think I actually lose sleep doing that. Plus, it wasn't fun waking up to watch the Rangers lose in game 4 and then see the Knicks losing a couple times in this Indiana series. So you've got the big game 6 tonight. And then out west, what's really great, Sunday, game 7, time still not announced, between the Nuggets and the T-Wolves. The way this series started, even as the defending champs, I'm sitting there going, I don't see how Denver is going to dig out of this hole. Infighting. Lack of cohesion on both ends of the floor. And what do? They come back and win game 3 in convincing fashion and eke out one in game 4. Then they fire it back around, grab game 5, take a 3-2 lead, and then lay an egg in game 6. So now you've got your opportunity here for Denver to keep this thing going. And do sort of what the Knicks did coming off a bad game 4 loss to Indiana. He's come back after getting pounded. And this time for Denver, it would be to win a series, which I think they will. As fun as this T-Wolves team is to watch, with Edwards and Cat playing really well, it's hard to sleep on the Joker. 3-time league MVP. It's just hard to do it. Is Minnesota capable of winning the game? Of course, especially this time of the year. Who do I like? I like Denver, and I'm not exactly going out on a limb there. Because then you take a look at what you get there. You've got a Thunder, the top seed in the West, against a 5-seeded Mavericks team with game 6 coming up. And Dallas has the 3-2 lead. after beating Oklahoma City by 12 points in game five. You know, I think a lot of people had Oklahoma City pegged for the West Final, and most probably Denver as well. And I think we've gotten better series than most expected, especially from Thunder Mavericks. Oddly enough, I do think the Thunder will get game six, and I think they'll kick it back to OKC for game seven. So you potentially could have the remaining NBA playoff series go seven games. If Indiana takes care of the Knicks tonight, it would go game seven back at MSG. Mavs could lose to the Thunder game six, which is Saturday, 8 p.m. tip on the Eastern Coast. That could go seven if that happens. And then Dallas, Minnesota. Three game sevens to get to the conference final. I mean, it's forget about what the fans want. This is everything the NBA will want. Game sevens are money. Game sevens are green. And you could get a bunch of them the next couple of nights. Which, you get game sevens. And you get theatrics in the postseason. But to come in the potential of bunches like this, with the star power that's involved in these games, in both the NBA and the NHL, with legacy teams playing, it just doesn't happen like this all at once. And I think we should appreciate what we're actually seeing here. With the exception of that Boston-Cleveland series, none of these contests have been walkovers. And I think it's a testament to how balanced these leagues, I don't know if they have become, or if the proper verbiage would be have become or are becoming. I think it's definitely a step in the right direction, where you want parity, where you're not getting just a smattering of dominant teams. I mean, a small market team last year won the NBA championship in the Denver Nuggets. I mean, it might not bring the sexy appeal necessarily, but you're drawing a new audience there. You know, MLB started to do that with trying to rework their rules and figure out game management and all that to appeal to the younger crowd. You know, I think the NHL especially has done a better job of that lately. And then when you see a postseason like this, where you could have a couple more game sevens as well in the NHL, it's all the better for the league and the people that invest their time and their money into it, because you're getting a quality product. And that's what you want, right? Fan short for fanatic. You want to be entertained. And we've had quality product put in front of us the last couple of weeks, and that's really all you could ask for. And if you're here in New York, forget it. This is what you dream of. Like, just for instance, from my perspective, as a Ranger fan, a Knicks fan, and a Yankee fan, the last month has been amazing. The Yankees, all of a sudden, and by the way, they're up on the horrible Chicago White Sox 1-0 now. The Yankees seem like they can't lose lately. The Rangers are in the East Final, and the Knicks have a chance to get to the East Final tonight. I haven't read a sentence like that with confidence, maybe ever in my life. That I've got two teams, one already in the East Final with a legitimate shot to win the whole damn thing, an NBA team that could replicate that, and a Yankee team that's 15 games over 500 that is very well probably right now the leader in the clubhouse to win the division 45 games into the season. Problem with that is now I'm gonna hitch my wagon to the New York Giants come September, and it's all going to come crashing down and burning. With that, Joe Jett on the line, our buddy Joe. What's up, man? How are you?
Hey, Peter. How you doing? How's everything going?
Did we have any heart palps last night? Are we doing okay?
You know, I made it through tonight. It was a wonderful, amazing night. I think the fans last night were the only ones in panic mode and not the New York Rangers.
I said it before. We had a call on the line. That's one thing about this team. There have been minimal instances this year where they've been outplayed. I can think of one earlier in the year against Nashville, but they don't get fazed, they don't rattle, and they don't sulk, if I can use that middle school word. It's very, very impressive, and it's encouraging.
It totally is. And, you know, we spoke last Friday night, Peter, and, you know, once again, I tip my cap to Peter Laviolette. This team lost yep. two games to Carolina. You know, it became a series when it didn't have to. And you know what? Whatever he did, whatever went on in between that second and third period, and Chris Kreider stood up in the locker room and said, I'm getting one. He didn't know he'd get three goals in that third period, but that was a sign as a leader and veteran on that team. Hey, we're going to come back, stick with it, and let's take care of business. And sure enough, they did. It was a great night.
And I'll tell you the thing with Kreider is, if you want to talk about parity, like I just was around sports and teams in general, think about it on an individual level with individual talent in sport, and take the NHL with the infusion of the young guys, the McDavids of the world, the Matthews of the world, the McKinnons of the world, with all that they've been doing in this league, you never see an uncontested, unanswered, natural hat trick at any time, let alone in an elimination postseason game. That is as much to the credit of Chris Kreider's ability as a veteran on this team as it is to the Rangers as one cohesive unit to be able to hold off another team from being able to respond after they had a two-goal advantage going into the final 20 minutes of play. Remarkable stuff you saw last night.
It really was, Peter. And, you know, it's funny, in hockey, it's like the only sport where you think this game is over, we're going to force a game seven, and in a matter of minutes, in 9 minutes, they scored three goals. The fans were stunned. They didn't even know what hit them. You know, Shesterkin was amazing again in that third period. You know, and you know what? They got out of there, and that's a good Carolina team.
Big time.
You know, they have good talent on that team. They never give up. They back-check and forecheck. They gave the Rangers everything they had last night. And, you know, in our favor, the Rangers came out on top.
So I figured you'd chime in if you had the chance to tonight, and you would want to talk about the Rangers. But I'm gonna segue to MLB in a little bit. I got to get another promo in momentarily. But before you go, I got to ask you two things. First, your thoughts on the Jets schedule, and I cannot include you whining about having three games in 10 days, because the same thing happened to the Giants last year. So I pick another avenue to drive down. And second, I want your thoughts on what happened to Scottie Scheffler today. You can go in either order. The floor is yours.
Okay. We'll go with Scottie Scheffler first, because I don't want to spend too much time on this. I read what happened. The guy gets arrested, goes to jail. He's stretching in the jail cell.
He gets arrested. They pull him out of jail, and he shoots a 66 2 hours later.
Ho-hum, 66. Yeah,
unbelievable.
Like, again, you know what? Can we just move on from this incident? It didn't seem that whatever it was, he's, you know, I don't really know the whole true story. I don't think we all do.
Well, what's interesting out there is apparently from a law enforcement perspective and then a tournament perspective, it's been a complete disaster where, you know, anyone that knows me knows how pro Leo I am. But apparently it's a bad job out there by them. I mean, you had a traffic accident where a guy was crossing the street and died, and they had to reroute traffic, and it was complete chaos. So as beautiful as Valhalla is, you're arresting Scottie Scheffler, who's got a PGA emblem on the side of his car as he's trying to go to his job, where it's 4 o'clock in the morning and he's not really even seeing what's happening. And he's trying to follow these directions. And you say he assaulted a police officer where the video shows otherwise. This is a bad look for them out there, and it's a terrible look for tournament organizers. And by the way, somebody died, which is the worst part of it.
I know. I totally agree. This was all, you know, a giant mishap or whatever the case is. We'll find out later what really went down in the whole bit. But I do want to, I'm glad you asked me about the Jets. Obviously, I'm a big schedule guy, you know, having season tickets for 30-something years. The schedule's always big when the games are and where, you know, the whole bit.
Well, I'm glad you want to talk about it, because I didn't, because your Jet fans always want to whine about something. So go ahead.
No, I have no whining about this schedule. Am I the only one, though? And everybody's flipping out that the game one is at Frisco on a Monday night. You know, my theory is, if you're going to play a good team, the NFC champs, get them in week one.
Yeah. Oh, God, yeah.
Get them in week 10. Get them in week one where, you know, nobody's in sync yet. You know, the Jets had Buffalo on Monday night last year, week one. They beat them with Zach Wilson.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, And look at it. The NFL did give the Jets a break. They gave him Frisco, but then they gave him at Titans. Nothing to write home about. Then they come home for our home opener against the Patriots, who are terrible. And then they're home for the Broncos, who are garbage.
And who could start Zach Wilson?
Right.
Oh, man, Wilson comes in, throws four touchdowns. There's going to be a mutiny.
Right. Peter, the Jets could possibly play Zach Wilson, Sam Darnold in Minnesota in London, and Geno Smith when Seattle comes into the Meadowlands late in the year. How would that be?
Well, I mean, if you think about it, from weeks 3 through 5 for the Jets, I mean, you could potentially be getting this. Drake May, Bo Nix, J.J. McCarthy, all in a row. New England, Denver, Minnesota. It's possible.
I totally agree. I like the schedule. And you know what? Kudos to the NFL for what they did. Everybody's going, why did the Jets get 7 primetime games and all of that? Well, they had it last year. And the catastrophe with Rodgers happened. So they're giving them one more shot to prove that, listen, we believe that you guys are going to have a good season. Aaron Rodgers is a major draw. And let's see if they can get back on track from what happened last year.
Yeah, I totally agree. Joe, listen, as always, I appreciate the call, brother. We'll obviously going to be in touch, but we'll get you on next week, and we got more hockey to watch, brother. More hockey of relevance to watch here in New York, dude.
You know what, Peter? Just one more thing to all the sure. Ranger fans out there who weren't lucky enough to remember the 94 Cup like I did. You know, enjoy the moment. Enjoy what's happening as far as it goes. I'm not guaranteeing anything, but enjoy it, embrace it, and enjoy the games.
You can guarantee what you want. It's that other guy that calls in sometimes that we don't want making guarantees here.
Yeah, right? There's no guarantee. All right,
thank you, Joseph. I'll talk to you, brother. All right, that's our buddy Joe Jett. Again, we mentioned him at the top of the show. Our first caller, Mike, chimed in, and a few minutes later, there he is, Joe Jett, big Jet fan, big Ranger fan. And I just want to make one more point. I am going to talk a little bit more about the NFL schedule momentarily. With this Jet schedule, weeks 3, 4, and 5, that me saying that the Jets could get May, Nix, and McCarthy all in a row is not a knock on those guys. I'm strictly saying it. I think they're going to be good pros. I'm strictly saying from the perspective of a very good Jets defense getting rookie quarterbacks 3 weeks in a row. It's something that could have the Jets defensive unit certainly licking their chops as the season creeps closer and closer to getting underway.
Hit subscribe and don't miss the next episode.
Sports Today with Peter Jay.
Yeah, all platforms here, Spotify, Podbean, Apple, you know the works, iHeartRadio, TuneIn, subscribe right across the board, social media, at Sports Today with Peter Jay, J-A-Y. I did mention, I want to get into a little bit of baseball. Yankees are red hot, an AL best 30-15 overall, first place in the AL East. Look, I know it's only 45 games in, but this looks good. And I also know I'm on the record as saying that I think this is the year that the Baltimore Orioles win another division title like they did last year. I'm not necessarily coming off of that because I do think the O's and the Yankees are two quality clubs and they're going to be playoff teams. But then what a difference a week makes, right? You would have even said that if the Rangers would have went down last night, because last Friday when we were on, the Rangers were playing an elimination game to get rid of Carolina in a sweep. And then Carolina almost kicked it back to the Garden for game 7, thanks to the heroics of Chris Kreider. That did not happen. But in a 7-day span for the Yankees, a 10-day span, if you will, if you go back even a little further, 3-game sweep of the Tigers in the Bronx. I get it. It's the Detroit Tigers, but they were a plus 500 team at the time of the series. Yanks then take 2 of 3 from the Stros at the stadium. Houston looks awful. This is a team right now, folks, that simply cannot get out of its way. Then you take 2 of 3 from Tampa in St. Pete, which is never easy to do. And then you get a historic sweep, more on that in a second, of Minnesota the last couple nights before opening a set in the Bronx with the really, really lowly Chicago White Sox. The Yankees sweep the Twins. And I'll put this in perspective for you. A couple of stats came across, and then there was a great one from the Yes Network. Yankees are a whopping 120-44 against the Twins since 2002. You take that stat even further when you look at what the Yankees did in that 3-game sweep. It was the first time the Yankees held an opponent to one run or fewer in an entire series since suffocating the Rangers in the 1999 divisional series. So that was some surgical work the Yankees did against a Minnesota team who I picked to win the Central and I'm still steadfast on. I thought the beauty of the recent stretch for the Yankees was the pitching. Luis Gil really continues to blossom. Kid made his debut in 21, but he still has rookie eligibility, so he's right in the mix for rookie of the year. 4-1, 2.51 ERA, 8 starts. 6 innings against the Astros and 6 against Tampa Bay in his last 2 starts. 4 hits combined, an earned run, 8 Ks. Now, he walks 6. That's really the only blemish in those 12 innings. But put him right in that AL rookie of the year mix. You got Mason Miller, the really good reliever from the A's who throws 100 miles an hour. Colton Cowser, who's been great for the O's in left field. And Willy Abreu, who leads rookies in hits in the American League, playing right field for Boston. Heels right in this mix. Parlay that with the performance of Clark Schmidt this season, who was really good in the finale against Minnesota. 5-1, 2.49 ERA on the season. This is shaping up to be, and by the way, this is a Yankee team whose rotation continues to get better. Stroman, Rodon, now Heel, and Schmidt. You'd like to see more consistency from Nestor doing all of this without Gerrit Cole. He comes back right, look out. Because, oh, by the way, you've got baseball's best bullpen. And double, oh, by the way, Aaron Judge is hitting again. And Juan Soto continues to hit. Jose Trevino is off to a nice start at the dish. And you're starting to see signs that the 25-year-old Austin Wells, who's getting playing time behind the dish, is the real deal as well. Kid's a player. Good news for the Yankees that came out. Yes, they're top in the division, 30-15 overall. But Juan Soto noted during the week that he is very much open to in-season extension talks, which is huge. Got to keep this kid here. 25 years old. Doesn't swing at garbage. Gets on base. Takes walks. Isn't greedy. Puts him in the porch. Walking double. And he's a Gold Glove outfielder. You got to keep him here. And I think the Yankees know that. You look around the league, I think one of the really, really fun stories has been Paul Skenes. The rookie pitcher out of Pittsburgh. A lot of the gentlemen that might listen to the show are familiar with his girlfriend, Libby Dunn, the LSU Olympian gymnastic star. But Skenes today gets his first win, second start, 6 no-hit innings, 11 Ks, struck out the first 7 batters he faced against a good Cubs team. As the Pirates continue to hang there in the mix, I mean, this kid hits 100. He's got an 86-mile-an-hour slider. The real deal. I mean, the break on his breaking pitches is just surreal. Yeah, it's early. But again, 6 innings today, no hits, no runs allowed, 11 Ks, 1 walk. And that's the 1 walk is as important as the 11 Ks. So he has certainly been fun to watch since he made his debut in Major League Baseball. O's still playing good ball. They're 7-3 in the last 10. Yanks 8-2, so they keep pace a game behind the Yankees in the American League East. Guardians continuing to play well, as are the Royals. 6-4 over the last 10, keeping pace with Cleveland a game and a half back. The West is still a little bit of a slog fest. You know, the Astros, the really miserable start. It's just there's no mojo with this team. Have they been better? Yes. Great? Absolutely not. But certainly after the 6-16 start that they had, there's sort of perhaps a little momentum, but I'm not liking what I'm seeing to this point, as they are closer to the bottom in the AL West than they are to the top. National League, Mets struggling. 10 games back now with the Phillies, who continue to fly, 31-14. Edwin Diaz hasn't been great. Said earlier today that the year off hasn't affected him from the injury. He knows his body better than anyone, so who am I to doubt that? But it just hasn't been great there for that the back end there with the Mets bullpen. The offense, it seems like it's stuck in the mud half the time. And you got the Phillies and the Braves at the top who are really going to slug this thing out. As the season progresses, Brewers lead the Central, Cubs on their heels, and then it's the Dodgers out West, 29-17. pretty balanced home and away. And it's a Padre team that's sub 500 along with Arizona that are seven games back. Both of those clubs, two game under 500. So this is the Dodgers division to lose, quite honestly, folks. Already a seven game lead. Next win will be their 30th of the year. Right now across Major League Baseball, only the Yankees and the Phillies have 30, at least 30 victories to this point in the campaign. So it looks like the Dodgers, it's too early to go into coast mode, but you can pretty much see what's coming as far as that division is concerned with Major League Baseball.
Make sure to leave a review. This makes our day and fuels future episodes.
Sports Today with Peter J.
All right, yeah, leave reviews across all platforms as well, specifically right here on Podbean, and you can put them on Spotify. And as many of you do, contact me on social media at Sports Today with Peter J. Peter J. J A Y. You got the PGA Championship going on. Xander Schauffele at the top, rounds of 62, record tying 62 and 68 today. He's minus 12, one ahead of Colin Morikawa, who fired a round 265. In impressive fashion. Saeed Theegala, still out there on the course. I love this kid. I thought he would play better at Augusta last month than he did. I'm in one of those team pools with my friends where you pick 12 guys, your low six count toward the scoring. Saeed is on both of my teams, and he's minus 10 right now. He's going to win majors. And as Phil Mickelson will tell you, all you got to do is get the first one, and they start to come. Scottie Scheffler, you heard all day they've been talking about the nonsense he went through today, comes back to the golf course and follows up his opening round 67 with a round of 66. He is three off the pace heading into the weekend. It wasn't great for Tiger Woods either. You didn't see too much coverage on across the ESPN outlets for Tiger Woods through 17 holes now. Seven over after a pretty solid 72 in round one, a plus one round for Tiger to start, but it's been ugly today. Through 17 holes, TW is seven over on the round, eight over for the tournament, so he will not be playing this weekend. And just quickly getting back to the NFL scheduling, you know that the Jets will open now. We had Joe moments ago, three games in 10 days to start the season. The New York Giants will open week one. No, it's not with the Dallas Cowboys. They'll be home for the Minnesota Vikings September 8th. Those in the area, that the openers of the Giant games are always fun to go to. Packed house. The weather's usually warm. A couple of roadies for the Giants, Washington and Cleveland follow. So it's going to be an interesting track of the Giants this year to see how this team develops and how they navigate this schedule. No Saquon Barkley. You would think Daniel Jones is ready to roll week one. If not, it's going to be Drew Locke, an improved offensive line, the influx of talent. Malik Nabers, the sixth pick overall in the draft. They get the Cowboys week four, Seattle on the road week five, Bengals and Philly back-to-back week six and seven at MetLife. Three primetime games for the Giants. And then what's really interesting is the Giants are going to play the NFL's first ever regular season game in Germany on November 10th from Allianz Arena in Munich against the Carolina Panthers. On the East Coast, that's a 9:30 a.m. start. So that's pretty interesting. And then they'll play the Dallas Cowboys on Thanksgiving for the second time in the past three seasons, along with three night games. The Giants, as if they weren't busy enough, they're going to be on the HBO docuseries Hard Knocks for the first time in the history of the program. And Netflix announced this week that they're going to carry NFL games this season. So the popular streaming site announced earlier that it will stream two NFL contests on Christmas Day, with the deal between the league and the streaming service running for 3 years as of now, this year. And in 25 and 26, Netflix will stream at least one game during the next couple of seasons. So there's a lot going on as far as the NFL is concerned. You got many games of note that the league put out. Ravens and Chiefs September 5th, Rams, Lions September 8th, December 30th. You got Lions, 49ers, a rematch of the NFC title game. That's going to be great. Eagles go to the Bucks September 29th, Chiefs at the Broncos October 20th, at the 49ers October 20th, November 28th, Giants at Dallas, and then the Dolphins at the Packers that same night for Thanksgiving. That day starts with Bears Lions in Detroit. So it's a fun schedule. It looks like it's going to be a schedule loaded with plenty of marquee games. And we'll certainly keep that rhythm going here and that theme going for marquee games, because the NBA and the NHL postseason continues to roll along. With that, we'll get out of here for this week. I want to thank our callers for chiming in, everyone listening live across multiple platforms, those of you who have connected with me on social media, at Sports Today with Peter J, Peter J, J-A-Y. Hit me up at any time, and you can subscribe across all platforms right here on Podbean, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, TuneIn, iHeart. You know all the works and how to do it by this point. Have a great week, folks. I'll see you all next week, Friday, May 24th, 7 p.m. Eastern Time, right here on Podbean Live, and we'll see where we are. There's going to be plenty of NBA, NHL, and baseball on the program next week. We'll see how it stands when we get there. Have a great week, folks, and as always, go Irish.
Listen to Sports Today with Peter J. every Friday at 7 p.m. Eastern on Podbean, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and iHeartRadio. We'll see you there.